In this video, we talk about RAM memory. Starting from a NAND data latch, we are going to design an example of RAM memory. We'll see, through the help of a simulator, the read and write operations. If you are ready, let's get started. We'll see an example of RAM memory for educational purpose. The general framework of this example is close to the way RAM is built today, but particularly the bit memory cell is different. We'll see in the next video the real memory cell. At the moment, we focus in understanding the general organization. I took this example from the book But How Do It Know? By J. Clark Scott. This is a great book if you want to understand the basic principle of computers, and I highly suggest it to you. Let's remember our memory cell of NAND data latch. You see, the light green wire is a logic 1, and the darker green is a logic 0. In this configuration, when set is 0, although I change the input data, nothing happens to the output. But if set is 1, the output takes the input value. So with set 1, I acquire the input bit, and with set 0, I memorize it. We raise our level of abstraction, putting the data latch inside our 1-bit memory symbol. We place 8 1-bit memory cells side by side, and we connect set inputs all together, thus creating a byte memory cell. And this is our byte memory symbol, one input for set and 8 for input and output data. Now that we can memorize a byte, we need to move it from place to place, for example, from an 8-bit cell to another. To move bytes, we use a bus. A bus is just a set of wires, in our case 8 wires, but for reason of space and simplicity, we draw it with two close lines. Usually, a bus connects a lot of different units. Since a bus is a shared resource, a unit cannot visit it for long. Especially, it cannot impose its output value after finishing its own operations. Our 8-bit memory cell has a problem. The output shows always a byte, so it would impose it to the bus. For this reason, we did something to uncouple the output of our unit and logic gates when they don't have to communicate, thus avoiding to busy the bus. This element is called enabler. It enables the byte to pass if input E is 1, and it puts the output to off if E is 0. The logic gate we use to build it is called tri-state, because the output can be 0, 1, or off, or high impedance. We are interested in the off state because the high impedance avoids to occupy the bus. We can easily build a tri-state with just one transistor. When input E is 1, the transistor is on, it is a closed circuit, and the data and input passes through to the output. If E is 0, the transistor is off, it is an open circuit, and the output shows a high impedance, which is what we were looking for. Now we place our enabler in a box. We connect our 8-bit memory cell with our enabler, and we have a register. Let's see how control the register. If set is 1, it acquires the input data, and if enabler is 1, it shows it on the output. But if we turn E to 0, the output goes in off state. If we now turn set to 0, we memorize the data, and changing the input data doesn't affect the stored byte anymore. Now we can place all in one box. So, managing set, we decide whether memorize the input data, and managing E, we decide whether show the memorized data on the output. Now we want to move a byte through the bus from a register to the other. On the left, there is a way to place a byte on the bus composed by an input byte and an enabler. To the right, we have some probes to read the bus. You can see the bus is free in a high impedance situation, and this situation is shown by the simulator in red color. We want to memorize a byte in register 1 and later move it to register 2. Here you are our simulator. I'm using CircuitVerse. It's an online free simulator. We want to move the byte corresponding to the number 128. So first bit is 1, all the other are 0. First we want to see what there is inside the registers. So I click enable and I can see inside the first register all the bits are 1. We check the second register. Inside the second register all bits are 1 as well. So to move the byte 128, first we click in the enable, we put the byte on the bus, and in order to acquire it inside the first register we click to set input. We put set input to 0, so now the byte 128 is memorized inside the first registers. We free the bus and now we can check if this number is inside these registers by clicking E, and we can see 128 is inside the first register. Now we want to move it from the first register to the second one, and so first we put again by clicking enable the byte on the bus, and we click the set of the second registers. Now we have acquired the byte on the second register, so we click set and we put the set to 0, and we free the bus. We check if the right number is inside the second register by clicking enable, and we see we have moved the byte 128 from the first register to the second one. Now that we can use buses and registers, let's remember an important component of our memory, the decoder. Here is a 3-to-8 decoder. Through it we can select one and only one of the output, setting properly the input. With 000 we select the first output line. With 001 we select the second output line, and with 010 the third one, and so on. We can have different types of decoder, for example 4 to 16 or 8 to 256. So now we have all the ingredients to design our RAM memory. Here you are our RAM memory. You see on top left we have a register called Memory Address Register, MAR. This register carries the address of a single byte memory cell. We use in fact the first 4 output bits for selecting through the decoder one of the vertical wires, and last 4 for selecting the horizontal ones. MAR has set connected with enable because we want to show input data on the output immediately. On the bottom we have the bit lines connected directly with our memory cells, other registers, and 2 lines for set and enable. In this way we select the cell to read or write. Since in every intersection we have a 8-bit register, this is a 256 RAM memory. RAM is for random access memory, because you see you can access every cell following no order, in a random way as you want. Now we see what is in the intersection. We see there is a register plus some logic gates. The first AND is on only when both horizontal and vertical wires are 1, thus enabling AND 2 and 3. At this point, if SET or E is 1, we give a signal to SET or E of the register R. So if we want to write to the register, first we select the right horizontal and vertical wire. Second, we put the byte we want to store on the bus, and third, we put set to 1. Let's see this configuration working with the simulator. We remember when there is a 1, the wire is light green. When there is a 0, the wire is darker green. And when there is a high impedance, the off state, the wire is red. You see, if vertical and horizontal wires are zero, nothing happens to set and E inputs of the register, no matter which value we put in set and E wires. If vertical and horizontal are both to 1, we select the cell. If set is 1, we acquire the data, and by switching E input to 1, we show the stored data on the output. We can now place this circuit in a box and continue with a little simulation. Here you are our 4 bytes memory RAM, where we can simulate read and write operations. We have 4 memory cells of 1 byte each. Inputs and outputs of each cell are connected to the same bus. On the bottom left, we have the possibility to put a byte on the bus, and on the right, we can read the bus through some probes. On the top, we use 2 wires for each decoder 328 to select the right cell. And last, we have the set and E lines connected with all the cells. Here you are in our simulator with our 4-byte RAM. We want to write and read a byte from a cell. We can choose, for example, the cell 4, this one. And so first I proceed choosing the right cell. I go to my decoder. Here we have a 328 decoder, but with just 4 memory element, I would just need only 1, 2 decoder. So the right combination is 001 and 001 here, both vertical and horizontal wires. I go to my cell, I see that vertical and horizontal input are both with a logic 1, because you can see the wire is light green, so it's a logic 1 in the simulator. Second step, I choose a byte, I can change it, this byte, and I put it in the right cell. So first I put it in the on the bus, enabling here. So now my byte is on the bus, and later we acquire with the set input, we acquire the byte on the right cell. We have already selected the right cell. So set 1 and later set 0. So now the byte is correctly memorized in the right cell. Now we free the bus, and now the right byte should be here. We can check if the right byte is here, enabling this cell, so this cell put the byte on its output, so on the bus, and we can read from the bus. So enable 1, and here is our byte. You can see is the same. This kind of organization is easily scalable, and here is a 65K RAM. With 2 8-bit registers, this is the maximum we can do, but nowadays normal RAM size for personal computers is 16 GB. This kind of RAM is called static RAM. It is very fast, but very expensive, because the cell is built with 4 NAND gates. Since the logic gates can work only properly powered, if we lose the power, we have no gates and no memory. This kind of memory is called volatile memory. We can place the circuit in a box and have only a symbol for the memory unit. As I said at the beginning of the video, this is an example of RAM memory. There are some differences with the real ones, but the general framework is the same. In the next video, we'll see how the real RAM cell is made. Please leave me a comment and let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put that thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.